Marco Robinson to present his book. Thank you. As you can see, I have technical problems today. Greetings, I am Marco Robinson. Pleased to meet you all. Thank you for coming today. And I have to say that this is my first IES event. And I have to say this, that you're very lucky to get such fantastic speakers today in one day. We had some really fantastic speakers. And I have to follow them. No pressure. Just that one. This one. That one or that one? That's that, the side one. Okay, got you. Right, okay. So I'll tell you a little bit about me so you can get to know me a little bit before I present the content today. Now, I've been in Malaysia for 12 tahun. Sudah. Celup Melayu. I love Malaysia. It's a great place. And to cut a long story short, I love recessions.
I don't like it.
And in fact, I have prospered in every recession, even when I was a baby. Because I drank Ali Cafe. So, I came to Malaysia in 1997. Do you remember that year? So, when I came over, I had never heard of Malaysia. And a lot of people told me, don't go, it's third world country, you have to wear mask. You remember the smog? So, I packed my mask before I came here. And they said that everyone lives in trees and it's all really bad. But that's what they told me. So, Malaysian company came over to recruit me to come here to basically turn around their public company. Now, when I arrived in Malaysia, it was in August 97, and I came for a week and absolutely loved it to bits and decided to move my family here and sell everything in England. That's where I'm from, by the way. And I started the business. In the third month, the company could not pay me. So I'm not Malaysian, and I'm in Malaysia with no money. So that was my crossroads, and my philosophy is that you have to have great hardship to become a great person. So after the third month of not paying me, I basically innovated the whole company, innovated the way we communicate with the staff and how we built the team. And I was able to take that company from 10 million ringgit in 1997 to 150 million ringgit in 6 months. So that's one of my track record, because you have to know the people that are speaking here today have got that track record because they can teach you how to do it. Last year, I started my company today in May in a cafe in Bangsar with no staff. And I took that company from zero to 35 million ringgit up to today in the recession. Now, if I can do that in Malaysia, and I'm not Malaysian, what does that tell you guys?
You can do better.
Because you've got more help than I've got. I don't speak the language very well. You do. Okay? So, it just shows you that you can succeed as long as you know how to do it. Right now. Oh, I'll start it again. No use. Doesn't work. Anyway, I'll speak alone. So let's talk about creative thinking and innovation. Does everybody know what innovation means? Hello? Is anybody in, or am I speaking the wrong language? Innovasi. Okay. Now, innovation means that you have to think differently to everybody else. You have to position yourself uniquely so you can offer something that's different in the market. Are you getting me so far? Okay. Now, to innovate, you have to have brass balls. Brass balls. Okay. I'm not going to explain that physically, but everyone in this room has courage, yes or no? So that's what it means, really. You have to have courage to do something in spite of the fear of failing. Now, innovation, you have to have space. You cannot innovate if you're distracted every day by problems. You cannot innovate if you are in crisis thinking. The best ideas come to me when I'm in the shower or somebody else's shower. And those ideas I'm able to build on and create something different. So basically, innovation is supported knowing that everything can be improved. Even Ali Kafi can be improved. Even your company can be improved. Because there's no such thing as perfection. And once you can do that, you can get that feedback in the market and start to do things. Now, innovation is also cultivated by focusing on what your company customer really wants. Who in this room has customers? Put your hand up if you have a customer. Hands are not working today, no? Put your hands down if you have a customer. Okay, you've all got customers, great. So customers are what drive your business and what make you money. Agree or not agree? Yes or no? Yes. So, to do that, you have to clarify your vision. Now, we've talked a lot of today about vision, but basically what it means is you've got to have the end in mind before you start. Does that make sense? Yes. It means you've got to read the end of the book and see what happens before you can start the book properly. Who's ever looked at the end of the book first? But that's ironic because you don't understand the rest of it. To see the picture, you have to visualize. You have to visualize customers coming to you, giving you money for your products. Does anybody here do that? Yes. How many people do that? That's critical to your growth, critical to your success, critical to standing here on a stage and talking to 1,000 people. So vision is where it starts. Then you focus on closing the gaps practically to meet the vision. So if your vision is to make a coffee brand that makes people feel very energetic, that's your vision, you have to close the gaps and to find the way to get to that energy vision that you've created in your mind, because your customer has to have the same vision. That makes sense? That's how you start branding yourself. Now, to keep that going, the gaps are a lot of things. Too many to mention today. But the first fundamental thing is to get the product right. Is to get the product or service right. And it's also being brave enough to start a business even though the product is not 100%. No business started with a 100% perfect business model. Apple computers went wrong all the time. Windows went down all the time. Lots of things didn't work. So that's what you've got to do. And you've got to make the tangibles intangibles so you keep creating that vision in people's minds. Also along the way, you're going to make mistakes. Who in this room has ever made a mistake? You're keeping your hands down. You don't want to show anybody you're making a mistake. We all make mistakes, but it's not making the mistake that counts. It's actually getting up from making the mistake. It's how fast you get up after making the mistake. Because I'm sure everybody in this room has been kicked and kicked and kicked and kicked, and it hurts. And you think by staying down, you'll be safer. But actually, you'll keep getting kicked all the time, because when you try something, you give up too easy. And the best position to be in is basically when you've got nothing to lose. Has everybody heard of that expression before? When you've got nothing to lose, God is on your side, because he wants to give you something. That's how it works. So nothing to lose is where your best energy comes from, your best thinking comes from. Because you know what? When you've got nothing to lose, you have to do it. Who would like to be more successful in this room? We all agree with that? So to be more successful, you have to get up faster after making the mistake. And learn what you're doing is the wrong way to do it, and try another way to do it. Has anyone heard of Thomas Edison? So what did he do? He invented light. No, that was God. Thomas Edison is one of the reasons you're sitting in this room today, because there's a light bulb shining down on this room. So he made 10,000 mistakes before he got the right way to do it. 10,000 mistakes. How many times have you tried to do something and failed? Once? Twice? People tell me all the time, I've tried thousands of ways, Marco! Thousands! Thousands! Thousands and thousands! Still no success! So I analyzed and asked them, well, what did you do? Well, I did this, and then I did that, and then I did that. So actually, you tried only 3 times. That's what it comes down to, guys. That's the courage it takes to keep going and keep going and keep going. Because the people in this room, am I right in saying this, don't want to have a salary. Right? My salary, my last salary was 12 years ago. I've not had a salary since then. A lot of people are afraid of that. I'm in a foreign country, no salary. Because salary comes from the Greek language meaning slave allowance. So if anybody tells you they have a good salary, what are they telling you? They're a really good slave. They're on the wheel like this. Yes, boss. Yes, boss. Yes, boss. I'll do it, boss. Yes, yes. I want promotion. I want more money. Ah. So salary will never make you successful. And that makes you creatively think about new ideas, because you have to create more income. If you're on a salary, you don't need to create more income, because you can pay your bills just about. But if you get fired, what's the first thing you do? Let's just test your mindset. The first thing you do, most people do, is look for another job. What they don't do is think creatively and think, how can they stop working? Because basically you're getting told a message. If you get fired, you should be very grateful you got fired. Because when you get fired, you have an opportunity to create a business. To do what? I'm having problems again. I'm not going to use that. It's not friendly today. So that's creative thinking. The next thing I want to talk about when you are making more money is how you communicate. Now, communication in English is a 13-letter word. That means it's a very long word. But why don't people use it more often? So to communicate with people, the first thing you have to do is smile. You know, our friend before said, the air hostess in the airplane, hello, welcome, hello, welcome, hello, welcome. That's not the smile. The smile comes from here. It's a genuine, sincere smile. Now, you may be thinking, why am I talking about smiling, such a simple thing? Because you may be thinking you're going to discount that as important. But what happens in a smile is that smile attracts a person to you. Because you're willing to smile. When you smile like this, you go like this. I can do that all day and people will come up to me and smile back. Now, you don't have to look a silly person when you do this. You just have to be natural when you do it. So smiling attracts people, but then what do you say to people when you talk to them? Someone mentioned building rapport before. Remember building rapport? Do you know what rapport is? Does anyone know? If you can tell me what rapport is, I will give you $100 right now. What is rapport? Anyone tell me? Building trust. Let me explain what rapport is. Rapport is when you know the other person. What? Is when the other person knows that you understand them. Let me explain that concept again. Many people don't know. It's when the other person knows you understand them. Because when the other person knows you understand them, what they do is they like you because you have taken the time to focus on them and understand them. Because people are shouting at you every day, "You don't understand me, mister. You don't understand me, therefore I'm not going to do business with you." But in Malaysia, we don't tell you that to your face, we tell everybody else. That's the difference, isn't it? So it's rapport building is basically is listening to the other person's point of view, even though it's boring. And some of you in this room today are listening to me, and perhaps you're not getting anything from it. And I have to accept that. Some of you are getting something from it. Some of you are getting text messages on your phone in your pocket. Your phone is vibrating. Ooh, ooh. I got an SMS. Oh. I cannot listen to the speaker anymore. I have to look at the SMS first. You sound familiar? So you kind of get your phone out of your pocket. You go like this. You can't see me, right? Okay. You kind of look down with one eye to see the SMS. Because when you see an SMS, it builds your self-esteem. You know that? Do you know that? When you receive a beep, beep, your self-esteem increases. You feel more confident and a better person because you received an SMS. That's amazing, isn't it? But true. It's so true. Time, please. Okay, so to wrap up, what I'm saying, to win your company through recession, you have to be a creative thinker, you have to communicate fantastically, you have to be a leader, and you have to basically do what other people refuse to do to get where you want to get. You have to defy the odds, and you have to do things every day to get to you where you want to go, not anybody else. That means you have to follow your dream, nobody else's. Thank you very much.